welcome everybody at Global Speedrun Association, and welcome to another World Peace Tournament quarterfinal today between Timpani and Suisega. And this is going to be a very anticipated match for me. This is going to be very close, very interesting. Timpani, the runner of all categories, the madman. He does it all, from all purple coins to all unique moons to talk to. He likes talking to birds. And speaking of birds, I have Dangers with me today in co-commentary. What's up, Dangers?
Well, how's it going? I'm doing very well. How are you?
I'm doing perfectly fine. Had a pretty stressful week at work, but I'm going to be enjoying some world peace quality racing.
Yes, and same with me.
Yeah. This is time to relax now. I'm gonna watch these runners take on each other here, and we have Timpani, I think, joining us right now. What's up, Timpani?
What's up, Lem?
Hello, my friend. So this one is an interesting matchup. I'm not sure you can probably tell us about the rule set here, because you will be playing on different versions. And I also want to hear your thoughts about the matchup in general, about World Peace Practice recently. I know you have been doing some talk to and some other categories, but I think you have been getting World Peace Practice in. But yeah, you take it from here.
Okay, so I disallowed FMS, but I did let him have Sewer Clip, so that's fine. As for practice, I actually did PB today. With a practice drum, I didn't have any splits open. I just ran it. I got a 117.58, so I'm feeling pretty okay on World Peace.
The 117, congratulations!
But I am still worried because obviously Sui is very well established with the any percent portion of this run. So that's probably what I'm going to be worried about the most, if anything.
Yeah, just keeping up. We did previously see how big that can be, especially when it comes to these later game kings. We did see the match between Rhea and Dangers obviously yesterday, and Stravos literally getting the world record in the category in one of our races here. So the movement options that you learn in any percent, and yeah, the movement overall does definitely come in handy here. But I think as far as the category goes, you are pretty seasoned as well. And once again, if you mess up one of these boss threats, if you mess up one of these story events like the festival, and I mean Bound Ball is hard to mess up, but still, the time loss will be heavy. But yeah, so Sewer Clip will be disallowed. I'm assuming you're not going to be going for it yourself, Timpani.
No, Sewer Clip, he can go for that. I'm not going to personally be going for it because I didn't practice it because I feel like sometimes I'll get it first try and then I'll be like, yeah, okay, and then it's not going to happen when it matters.
Yeah, to understand that Sewer Clip is way, way harder and way less lenient on version 1.2, so something that Suisega might be able to take advantage of. However, Timpani is going to have an advantage when it comes to load times, because he's going to be playing on the digital version of 1.2. But other than that, Timpani, I wish you best of luck. Obviously, best of luck to Suisega, even though he's not here. And yep. I hope you do well.
Thanks.
All right. All right, Dangers, it's time. Runners leaving, predictions time.
I'm very excited about this one. It really, really could go either way. Timpani and Suisega, both very well known for their consistency in their respective categories. Obviously, it takes a lot of consistency to run a category like All Unique Moons, for example, where you have to maintain a high level of gameplay all the way through an 8-hour run. Timpani kind of carries that into all of the categories that he plays. And I think that is one of his very strong suits. But as far as any percent goes, maybe only Chaos Pringle is a runner that I would consider being as consistent, if not more so, than Suisega. So this here could be a very fantastic race, very close all the way through.
Definitely. Yeah, Chaos Pringle, probably the most consistent any percent runner right now. But that didn't help him here, because obviously there is a lot of strategies and a lot of movement that you can't really, like, you can't come up on the fly with that. You do need to practice these movements. You do need to practice these boss fights. But I think we are off now. Suisega and Timpani starting the gameplay here. World Peace Tournament quarterfinal. Timpani versus Suisega starting now, and obviously going to be starting at Cap Kingdom.
Yes, the most exciting kingdom. Everybody's favorite reset point. The big trick here being, of course, first moon skip, the left side. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's kind of just one of those things you got to have a feel for.
It is true. And I do think another interesting dynamic for this one is going to be that Timpani is probably more seasoned. I mean, he obviously does left it in a lot of runs, but most of the runs when he was grinding all unique moons, he would probably get the checkpoint and just go for the right side movement. So Suisaga probably has done more left side cap towers in his life, but obviously not the biggest time loss if you do mess it up.
Indeed, we're looking at about 3 seconds for a fail there, unless you bonk, and then it's about 5, but you're right. It's it only seems big because it's there at the very beginning. It's one of those things that you don't mind resetting for because you're only about a minute and a half in, so.
And Timpani actually snagging in a little bit of a lead here at the start of Cap Towers, Cap Kingdom. It's obviously not that much, but still interesting to see here. Because as you said, this would be the place you reset to most in any percent. I guess World Peace is short enough that you can get a decent amount of cap resets in, but any percent being even less lenient with time losses here.
Indeed, and I think that just comes with how tight and how optimized that category really is. You know, if you can save a second somewhere, it might as well be in the first 2 minutes that you can kind of lose later on and not feel so bad about it.
Nice, and both runners getting left side here. Not a problem for them, as Timpani actually misses the jump there on top of the head. This is really annoying, and it feels, every time that happens to you, you'll feel like the biggest casual player, but it will literally happen to anyone.
Indeed, it happens to me sometimes as well. And it also is another one of those things that feels like a huge time loss, but really we're only talking about 5 seconds at the most here.
Exactly. And as we said before, there's way bigger time losses coming up. I guess Suisaga not doing first moon skip won't throw him off too much. The movement there is usually pretty easy. You can be a little bit fancy and capture the change in a cool way and do like a specific dive out it. You can even improve that part of the run. But I'm pretty sure Suisaga does not know about these strats. We'll see if Timpani goes for them. They are very small time saves though, so it won't even matter in the big picture. Yeah, Sui trying to go for the double jump there, but not making up. This was one of the optimizations I was thinking about. Also not getting the quick dive. Not a big problem, though.
It's familiar enough with just how a chain chomp works, really, to just kind of break open the rock and he's on his way.
Yeah. Probably a little bit easier than the first moon skip, which, however, saves around 24 to 25 seconds. So that's a nice option. I'm interested to see if we are going to be seeing chest clip moons here instead of the cliff moon, especially for runners like Suisaga, that is very confident, probably, with the chest clip. We'll see if that actually is something that he decides to use.
Indeed, something we've actually recently proven is faster than getting above a high cliff if you are able to pull the clip off correctly. And I think that Timpani has started utilizing this in his run. We might actually see this from both runners here.
Yeah, I'm interested. It would also be interesting if they for some reason were tied after Madame Brutal and we would see like a live comparison. But that probably won't happen unless Suisaga was to miss up one of these hits here. And this boss, I mean, I think this is actually the boss you rely most on with like visual and audio cues and also muscle memory. Every time I take a break, I can't fight this boss.
Indeed, yeah. You kind of have to be paying attention for this one. And a lot of the other bosses in World Peace, a lot of the End Kingdom bosses, are rather linear. And I've mentioned before that there is some optimizations that you can do and stuff like that, but they're not very queue-specific. It's just about knowing where you need to be at what times and stuff like that, so.
Exactly. So Suisaga getting a perfect fight, basically, Timpani as well. Suisaga also grabbing some coins, which is completely optional because you do not need them at all in the World Peace category. However, it doesn't obviously lose time if you just grab them between the phases. Gives you something to do, doesn't mess with your any percent muscle memory, so who cares?
Indeed. I find that I just do it out of instinct because I need to fill the time with something.
Exactly. All right, so Suisaga coming up at that very last moon here. I'm interested what choice he is gonna make because I'm not completely sure if he's aware of these timing differences. Maybe he's just gonna be opting for cliff and he actually will, it looks like.
Yeah, Suisaga just going for what he knows, I imagine. And Timpani following suit. I think maybe they're opting to, because it is slower if you miss the cliff. Correct.
Not only that, you also want to be getting a decently quick chest clip as soon as you mess around a little bit too much on the chest, it would be even or potentially even slower. So I cannot really blame them, especially in a race format. Like, that's something you might be going for in these hardcore any percent runs where you really want to push your time. I mean, in these hardcore world piece, like attempts, when you're doing attempts and resets are something you can just do. That's something you might want to do. But here in this one, you obviously can't reset. So probably the smarter choice, actually.
Indeed. Sometimes when it comes to those 0.5 second time saves, going for the easier thing is the safest bet for a race.
Exactly.
And now, I used to not like the Sand Kingdom very much in World Peace. I thought it was rather boring. Mm-hmm. But with these new route optimizations and complete overhaul of where we go, it's kind of bumped up my list a little bit. It's probably one of my favorites now.
So if Snow didn't have the downstairs clip, it would be my favorite kingdom, I think, in this run. But with that, I'm pretty sure any percent does take, not any percent, Sand does take the win here as my favorite kingdom in World Peace.
And is that because of the bosses, or is that because of just the routing and how kind of fun and technical it is?
Exactly. It's super technical. It's super creative. Yes. Using this bullet bill in ways you usually wouldn't use a bullet bill, and abusing like mechanics we just recently found. It uses like everything. Like it's my kind of stuff. Like some of these techniques I actually have been involved in personally, like timing the difference between holding Y and something on the bullet bill. So I really like that putting to good use. And I even found like a fast version of the checkpoint grab. That's not the main thing. It's just super technical, and I really like watching and playing Sand.
Indeed, it's a lot of fun to watch as well. I think that it's just a very creative use of the capture mechanic in this game, you know, with Dramstrat included as well. Just like really utilizing the bullet bill for absolutely everything that you possibly can do with it. And it makes me wonder if maybe we're overlooking some of these kinds of things in other kingdoms as well. It's just we haven't kind of developed the creativity for that kind of thing yet.
Yeah, one thing, Timpani actually unfortunately missing the Dramstrat here. He is going to be getting the recapture on that bullet bill, but I think Sand really like has it all. It has clips, it has these the Dramstrat here, pretty technical trick. It has the fast bullet bill catch later on. Isui's actually getting IP clip their third try. Not the best. Let's see how Timpani is going to be doing here though, because clips are harder on version 1.2.
Indeed. Timpani has this kind of Illuminati conspiracy going on right now that the door is open on Tuesday. Unfortunately, today is not Tuesday. But he does seem to get in the wall with
third
very
try
little
as well.
Difficulty. Yes, very, very quick. And I don't think he had any bonks, so he actually makes up a little bit of time on Sui Saiga for the clip.
Yeah. And not quite sure. I think he did bonk on the first time, but that's something that really doesn't matter in the big picture here. What is going to be mattering here in Sand are these fast bullet bill grabs and also the boss fight itself. And obviously also the Knight Sand movement. That's going to be really big here. Timpani did end up missing the Dramstrat, so he definitely lost some time there over Sui. But the Knight movement with the bullet bills is very essential to get a good Sand Kingdom.
Indeed. And making sure that you really tuck yourself into all of the cycles of the bullet bills. If you're just like a little bit too slow on any of them, you tend to miss one of the bullet bills and have to wait for the next one. So it'll be interesting to see if they're able to get all of the movement in for that trick.
And Sui Saiga already fighting Harriet here. Harriet does have a little bit of manipulation happening. I mean, if you guys have seen Harriet in Bowser's, there's specific spots you can stand on to make her jump a little less. These spots basically also exist here in this fight. You want to know where you are standing to make her hop less.
Indeed. And then you may have also seen from the Bowser fight a strat developed by Fur, which involves going into first person and throwing your cap early. You can do something similar here, except you don't need to worry about where you're aiming because it's directly forward. So if you know when Harriet stops, if you know how to manipulate her hopping phase in an optimal way, you can usually throw your cap slightly early so that the bombs don't have to fly as far.
However, I do want to say this fight is actually, at least for me, makes it easy to like drop a dive input as well. I think like these busy sections overall sometimes make it hard on you to get your inputs in. But not a big problem for these runners here, getting decent fights. I think Timpani had a little bit of an issue on the last phase of the manipulation, so she jumped around like 5 times, which is not optimal. But as I said earlier, the knight part here of Sand Kingdom is going to be the essential one to leave this kingdom. Actually, not only the knight part, but especially the ice caverns, the hole in the desert, basically, in which Nagvatek is going to be waiting for them. This is a place where you can easily die. Not just once, but probably like three times. There's literally three super scary sections.
Indeed, we've seen it a bunch of times in this tournament, actually.
Yep.
There's a couple of very scary jumps involved with capturing the bullet bills in the ice cavern. Again, just like adding it to the list of really cool strategies involved with these bullet bills in the Sand Kingdom. And just really, it comes down to knowing what you need to do and pulling off the tricks well.
What? That's actually so sick. I didn't know about that. Did you see that?
Oh, Sui Saiga. Wow.
Whoa. That's crazy. That's so cool. So Sui actually manipulated the bullet bill there in a way that he could just throw Cappy backwards and then even already spawn in the other bullet bill. It was actually so hot. I'm a little bit confused. That was super hot.
That's brilliant. I think the idea there is that the bullet bill from the lower cannon only spawns within proximity. So he's luring the first bullet bill to a place where he can spawn the second bullet bill early. Very, very smart.
We did get a little bit distracted by that. That was definitely fast and super hot, but Timpani also managed to get a clean movement here in the night section of sand. So if Sui was to take a death here in these caverns, that would already probably mean a tie as far as these paces go. And the first hard jump is coming up right here, basically, where you do need to capture this bullet bill. And even if you capture it, you do need the fast speed on the bullet bill. If you mess up anything, you won't make it over.
That's right. And this is another one of those strategies that was just recently discovered. Letting go of Y after the very first shake allows you to maintain your fast speed. Sui Saiga blasting through the cavern very quickly.
Yeah, and by the way, that strat allows us even to do the route entirely, because you wouldn't actually be able to grab the checkpoint and make it over to the pillar like efficiently without that strat as well. So this comes in handy in different places. But Sui Saiga, very clean Sand Kingdom actually. If we look back, third try IP clip, but other than that, not really any major mistakes, and definitely playing super solid. He did get Dram, he did get a clean knight section, no mistakes, but Timpani capturing the bullet bill as well, so both of them very solid sands.
Yes, indeed. And this here boss fight, Nakotek, we've seen this boss fight in many places in Mario Kingdoms before. Very simple hands and face boss type of fight. Of course, Cappy brings in kind of another unique perspective to the fight, where you capture the fists and throw them back into his face to cause damage to the boss. Another one of these bosses where you kind of just have to wait around for the boss to do his thing, but there are a couple of optimizations involving manipulating the boss, specifically by rolling in between the fists during this phase that we're seeing Timpani do right here.
Sui Saiga getting clapped. Nakotek having no mercy and clapping him there. Obviously not the biggest deal, as long as he doesn't die, because a death in this fight would be quite embarrassing, but he is on his last phase. Wait, is he? Yeah, he is.
Yes, just so finishing
gets that done.
And Timpani right behind.
Timpani right behind, getting the hit here quickly. And both of them are going to be off to Lake Kingdom, which is using the current any percent route. At least what most people currently do in real time. But another place where Sui Saiga might have a slight edge. However, Timpani obviously also did those moons not just once, but a million times almost. I mean, obviously not a million times, but he's very familiar with these moons that they're going to be getting in Lake.
Yes, it's not an incredibly technical kingdom. Not very much can go wrong, I suppose. Just a couple of perhaps slightly trickier jumps towards the beginning and end portions. But aside from that, very easy kingdom to kind of zip through. No pun intended.
Ha-ha! Get zipped. But Timpani actually missing the globe there. Not going to be losing much time off of that. But that always feels unfortunate. It feels like you are forceless there, Cappy being out in the air, and you just stand there awkwardly trying and waiting for him to return. But yeah, Suisega already off to Lake. Timpani still has to select that kingdom unless he wants to do a wooded first here, which is something that literally doesn't make sense in this category because it's just faster to just spam A here.
Doing some MeWe strats. It makes sense. MeWe strats. It does make sense in the context of runs, perhaps. If you are a little bit scared of the wooded kingdom, you can kind of save yourself 3 minutes by going there first. And if you think you're going to reset, you've at least saved 3 minutes of your life. But in a race setting, not entirely important.
But what kind of attitude is that? You literally go into the kingdom thinking you are going to reset to wooded anyways.
That's true.
That doesn't sound too good. But I guess that's a personal decision, so it's up to him. But these runners know the drill here, and they're going to be going to Lake, and once again, going to be selecting these fastest moons here. No Lake clips to be found, since that might not even really save time in this category. So, there is, I theorize something where you could maybe do the clip and still fight the boss, but we won't see that in, like, forever. So, normal moon choices here.
Yeah, we're starting to see the any percent runners kind of experiment with that a little bit. Only one crazy enough to pull it off in a run, perhaps, is Stravos, who has a bit of a reputation for doing all of the harder things in runs before anybody else does, which does come with a kind of a long-term benefit. But in World Peace, considering Rango is required, the late clip does not really add any benefit to this category as a result.
And yeah, Suisega already off fighting Rango here. There's a pretty cool strat that I've been messing around with. You can actually buffer a spin pound as you roll towards the boss fight and then start up with a spin pound jump dive, which is definitely faster for the first hit, but you can easily hit the head because you might actually be too fast. And Rango still has his head out trying to throw it at you.
Right, so, I've seen you doing that actually. Yeah. It seems very interesting.
Super small optimization. Feels fantastic to pull off, but something that I wouldn't do that in a race, even myself. I would also not recommend that to anyone. In a race. Do this in your attempts. It feels fun.
Yeah. Do it on your own time.
Exactly. But yeah, Timpani just barely behind here, heading into Wooded Kingdom, which is a pretty big one. Obviously, Wooded Sand. These big kingdoms have a pretty big storyline happening in them, so they will obviously go through all of that. And then also Wooded does have the potential gate skip here, which can be, I'm not even sure if we've seen anyone fall into the deep, but I feel like people have figured it out, but there is always that chance that it might actually screw someone over.
Indeed, I've actually noticed that more often than not, my failed attempts just tend to bonk on one of the walls on the out of bounds portion, and then I just fall into the area where the switch is. But when we didn't know the timing for the dives, it was a lot easier to kind of make it past those walls and then not up to the barrier itself and then dive into the deep woods. So we're kind of at like a midway point here where we're not losing incredible amounts of time by falling into an area we're not supposed to be in, just falling kind of backwards, you could say.
But yeah, Wooded starting off quite familiar here for Suisega. We are going to be getting the first to any percent moves as always. Quick rock, quick bunny. No shop though. And he's going to make it over to the, I guess, stream section and waterfall section immediately. And I'm sure that he's at least going to be attempting the gate skip because I did already see him almost like a month ago messing with that when he was just getting into World Peace. So I'm pretty sure he's at least going to be going for it.
Yes, and I know that Timpani is definitely an advocate for the trick as well. Looks like Suisega has got the clip there.
Very yes, quick in. Clip. And actually, maybe deciding to just use that clip to go through the wall, it didn't even look like he missed the cap dive, so he probably wasn't even opting to go for that, which actually surprises me. Maybe he does have some recent memory with that going wrong, but I'm not sure. I've seen him pull it off before.
And it is just a kind of a scary thing, you know, even if you know that the deep woods is not a very common thing anymore, it can still kind of linger in the back of your head and you just never know in a race, right?
Exactly. And Timpani not getting the clip, which is not a big deal at this point, because obviously Suisega did not even go for the gate skip. That is just basically him skipping that wall. Suisega very low there with that interesting quick strat. It is quite risky because obviously, once again, this is a deep woods loading zone, but Suisega making it past it without any issues. He is going to be getting to one of the scariest sections of Wooded though, which is going to be the Flower Road and Tower Skip section.
Yes, in World Peace, it's kind of a two-for-one deal. in any percent. I think actually every category goes for this Flower Road skip, which, yeah, as fancy as it looks, only saves about 2 seconds optimally. But then you have to follow this up with another giant leap over the death zone, and that is the tower skip. World Peace actually taking out the tower moons because they're just a little bit too slow.
The double skip. And yeah, these moons are actually quite fast, but since we have to do more in the storyline, we are going to be getting some faster moons. And obviously we have some moons that we have to collect, which are these World Peace and Story moons before the actual Torque Drift fight. So it's just not worth enough to use these loading zones. But Timpani, interesting angle. They're playing it a little bit safer, making a big turn to make the Flow Road skip happen. But as long as he makes it over, he's going to be fine. Interesting angle. Almost falls down. Gets over though.
Did look like he almost lost a little bit of speed or something there as well, so it was definitely a smart choice to make the rainbow spin there.
Timpani cutting that corner very close, actually landing on one of these little girders in the middle section of the tower. They intended, it looks like, though. Very quick tower skip.
Even used a cap or turn bounce to get up to, yep, Spirit as well. It was a very on-the-fly smart strategy there.
One of the cleaner tower skips I've seen so far. Suisega, however, already done with the Spirits fight. He is basically gaining these little leads of Timpani, having some unfortunate bonks here at the start of the section. Obviously, still these sand mistakes, the missed dram probably being the biggest one here that Suisega is riding on right now with that lead. However, he is going to be getting to a pretty scary jump, in my opinion. It's not scary, but every time you want to do it fast, there is a chance of dropping an input and falling. So let's see if Suisega is going to be approaching that slow. He's actually going very quick, and he manages to get the jump easily.
Indeed. And one of my favorite parts of this run, actually, is this whole wooded climb. It's quintessential speedrunning, you know? You get from the very bottom of the stage to the very top in about a minute's time, using basically everything in Mario's arsenal in order to get there. So very, very cool section to watch.
Truly, especially this movement here with the Rocket Flower. You can even elevate that a little bit with the specific Rocket Flower reset strat. That is kind of a myth at this point. I think we have been talking about it a lot, but never really to be seen. And pretty much Equid being one of the only runners that has ever pulled it off. So it's pretty much a myth. It is a thing, though. We might see it at some point. But other than that, you really use all of the mechanics that this game has to offer to climb that section. Very quick shots here from Suyu as well.
Yes, this little target practice section. Once you know kind of how the cannonballs work and how far your shots go, then this particular section is not very tricky, but the cannonballs coming out of the targets actually are RNG and can sometimes roll right into you, which can be a little bit frustrating.
Oh, almost the beautiful shots there. Timpani actually getting denied at the very end there of one of these RNG cannonballs we just talked about. However, he's probably only around 25 seconds behind, and everything coming up right now, which is going to be Cloud Kingdom, which is going to be this boss fight, Lost Kingdom, is easy actually to make one of these guys lose a lot of time, and the race can change its tides. Also, one thing that I want to already look out into the future now, because Torque Drift is one of the less exciting fights to watch, Moonclip is probably going to be a very big one here. Timpani usually is pretty consistent with that one, and I'm not completely sure if Sui did practice that enough to have good consistency. He is on 1.0, so doing the actual roll cancel clip would be a little bit easier for him. However, if he was to miss that could be huge here later, obviously later in the run.
Indeed. And one of the choke points of this World Peace tournament, we've seen a couple of races even switch hands in the Snow Kingdom for that reason, following it up with Bound Bowl as well. And I think some people underestimate just how Bound Bowl can really change the tides of a race.
For sure. So one phase between these two, by the way, just hit Torque Drift basically at the same time. Suisega only having to hit him one additional time, and Timpani still twice. But other than that, it is still a close one. And Cloud Kingdom coming up, a kingdom where if you make a minor mistake, it punishes you with a very big time loss.
Indeed. And I think we all have the fast strats down, but I think the second phase of this cloud fight tends to be sometimes random. Sometimes you can do everything right and it still feels like Bowser will take his hat back or something. Yep. So
Timpani jumping across these lasers. The Suisega shows off a pretty neat spin pound. They're probably actually being fast enough with that one to save a little bit. You can. There's different options to get these multi-moons. You just don't want to miss them. Spin pound, obviously, one of the coolest looking ones and probably fastest if you get a quick one. But Timpani also done with the boss. Suisega off to Cloud. Timpani off to the Odyssey.
Yeah, still a very tight race. I cannot recall any major mistakes Suisega's made at this point. So it's basically Timpani just playing catch up right now, but keeping very good pace with Suisega regardless.
Yeah, for sure. However, I'm interested in Cloud Kingdom because once again, it is a very essential kingdom for a successful race. Every time you get there, you just want to get through because if you miss one of these heads, you will be losing 8 to 12 seconds depending on the phase you're actually missing it in. So yeah, definitely scary one.
Indeed. And all it takes is one of those phases to really tighten the gap up here for Timpani.
And yeah, and that's not even considering Lost, which is going to be immediately after that one with all these death zones around and the Klepto trigger threatening these guys as they go through that place. But let's focus at Cloud here first. So Suisega actually doing a very interesting spin pound roll cancel strategy to activate a Cloud early, getting over there, starting his fight.
I like that a lot, actually. It's a little bit less risky than the Cloud boost strats that I've seen some of the Any% runners do, and a little bit more stylish than the safe one, but kind of somewhere in the middle. I like it a lot.
It is true. Probably a decent version to try out yourself if you want to improve your start here. However, the potential to improve a Cloud Kingdom time is very limited as you really struggle. By the way, the movement that Timpani was doing there is something I've seen Miles Pro, an IL runner of this game and also a full category runner at this point, do a lot. And that was on the fastest theoretical timesheet for a very long time. Just doing like a roll boost and another roll boost on the second clouds, because it has such a direct line, just seems to be the fastest option if you don't do the cloud boost, which is interesting. Way less flashy, but actually super fast.
Yeah, very interesting to see. I have not done that one myself either, actually. But Suisega not having any problems with Bowser here.
Yep.
Managing to make it to Lost Kingdom just fine. And this is where things can really shake up. You don't want to take a fall anywhere here because it could mean somewhere in the realm of 20 seconds of time loss.
And talking about that meme tree was actually super hot here. Suisega got I don't know if you caught that, but he actually shook his controller to make Cap return in time, which I really liked it because I seem to struggle sometimes with getting the Cap return jump, but he intentionally shook his controller to home Cappy back to him to then get the return jump guaranteed. Really cool. Very hard to catch, but that's actually a pretty nice option there.
That's brilliant, actually. Usually, if you're very accurate with your throw, then you kind of return the cap as you're approaching it. But that's a very solid option to kind of guarantee that.
Yeah, exactly. Basically guarantees the return jump, which is what you want. Because without the return jump, you might either lose. And wow, that triple jump, very, very sexy here from Sui. Really like that one. Not sure if that was intended. It's probably not even that fast to do it from that angle, but he managed to make that work and it looked very clean as well.
Yeah, making the Lost Kingdom look really easy, in fact.
Yep. Once again, a very familiar place for him. This is Any% movement right now. Everything he does here is what runners would do in the Any% category. Also, that triple jump here, very scary one. Gets it without an issue, though.
Nails it, yep.
Last moon, also not a problem for him, as he's probably going to be able to stay alive as well. So that was actually one of the most solid losts I've seen in a while.
Essentially textbook, I would say.
Yep.
And there are a couple of optimizations that we've noticed in Lost Kingdom within the last couple of weeks involving the moon that Timpani just got. You can kind of manipulate these tripedals to throw Cappy after you've already got the moon off the cliff. Saves a couple of seconds, but it's also kind of a risky strategy that nobody's really started to use yet. But aside from that, Lost is one of those kingdoms that you either do right or you do it horribly wrong. So being safe is kind of the key here, but also you still got to be fast. So
Yeah, and Timpani, also, obviously not a bad loss. He was still basically going through this kingdom without any major mistakes. However, he did have a bonk at some point, and he chose to be a little bit more safe at the cage mode. Also had a little bit of issues there to get Cappy on the globe, so losing some time here. However, Metro is another place where we will be seeing more World Peace exclusive routing again. It's also going to be a place where Suisega is going to be having access to the sewer clip, which was previously allowed by Timpani. However, it is not guaranteed to get that clip quick enough to actually save time with it, so that might be an interesting factor as we go there.
Indeed, a potentially strategic move by Timpani. I guess 1.2 players kind of have the upper hand in deciding these kinds of things. And, you know, we can always study our opponents and say, hey, like, if this guy's really good at sewer clip, I can force him to take the time loss if I choose to. But Timpani perhaps being a sportsman, or perhaps knowing that Suisaga's had trouble with it in the past, is allowing it this time, so.
It is interesting, obviously, to note that Suisaga is not forced to do the clip. He has that option to him. If he didn't feel good about it, he could still just do basically the same 1.2 route here. Timpani actually jumping on that lower step, barely making it up there with a capsule on the wall. But Suisaga actually very, very fast movement there after the swaying in the breeze moon, getting into City Hall pretty much perfectly. And also, definitely beautiful climb. He's playing very clean at the moment.
Indeed, he's got to be very happy with his current pace overall. Again, I cannot recall very many mistakes here.
However, Timpani still managing to stay behind the unfortunate bonk there on his side, but he's basically just entering City Hall as Suisaga is starting the Wiggler fight, deciding to not skip the cutscene immediately, but he is going to be fighting the boss, obviously. And this one, recycle, is the keyword here, can be scary. Timpani actually takes an unfortunate bonk.
A little bit of a bonk there, just having to get up in time for the second phase of the elevators, so he's going to be still climbing up rather quickly. Kitchen agrees, she knows all about this City Hall.
Yep.
And just how scary it can be. I actually took a fall in City Hall in my most recent race against Rhea. Fortunately, didn't make the jump that Timpani is about to make right here, with hope that he is able to clear the gap.
And gets over there, just made it. Roll boost there on the railing. I think the most annoying part about City Hall actually is Suisaga is going to be coming up at the Suicycle, which I do not want to take away from him. Let's see if he actually gets that before I bring up the disgusting poles in Super Mario Odyssey. Suisaga actually needs to snipe here. This is close. Oh, he's actually going to get a 3-cycle. What?
Last second.
He actually made that work. There was actually sniping.
That's a frame perfect. It must be.
Dude, these three shots, they were actually insane. He shot like three times Wanted, the movie, you know, where you can like drift the bullets.
he curved it. He's a legend.
Yeah, he's actually the Belgian sniper right here. He manages to get that 2-cycle in just barely. He probably lost some time in that Wiggler fight, but that was actually so big. If he missed that, Timpani would have been able to catch up a lot.
Indeed. I think that 3 cycles are about 20 seconds, if I'm not mistaken. So it's very good that he was able to sneak that in.
Yeah. Obviously, depends on how well you make that 3-cycle work. However, Timpani with a textbook Wiggler here. Definitely very, saving very time over Sui on that.
Yeah, the idea there is to get the Wiggler before he even stops moving, and Timpani's been able to manage that just fine, making up a little bit of time here.
Wow. Very confident throw there from Sui. Not hesitating with that one, and he is going to be getting that warp as well. I wanted to bring up the poles in the City Hall. We might not even get the chance to talk about them, but they are awful. Just don't forget, these poles are awful, and sometimes you can't regrab them. As Suisaga is getting the scooter clip without an issue, and he is, in fact, going to be going for sewer clip, as this moon basically signals that for us.
Yes, that's basically the slowest of all the moons in the outdoor section. It used to be Bench Friend. But we did time this under the garbage moon to be a little bit faster, in fact. So, yes, by grabbing that moon, he's kind of signaling that he will be going for the sewer clip here.
Yeah, because he is going to be skipping that moon inside of the sewer section, since he won't even go there at all. But very clean start here from Timpani as well, also confident throw. He is getting stuck at this very tiny ledge. That's actually the most annoying ledge in the game.
It's very triggering.
He won't even get the capture mob here because... getting stuck on that one little ledge, on that tiny ramp that leads up to this moon, is the most frustrating thing, and my reasoning to not go for a fast throw there and play it safe. But yeah, let's see how the scooter goes. Ah, sadly missing
the clip. Yeah, the timing for this one, especially if you're going for drive-by strats like Timpani is, can be very frustrating. He's opting to just actually visit the Bench Friend.
Dude, I can respect that. Capture taken, to be fair, visited his French there on the bench. That's usually a moon that you would even cut on 1.2 as it's still a little bit too slow and would be faster to get glittering above the pool. However, since he missed that, he is still going to be getting that pool moon as well.
Yes, and I can understand the frustration of not getting the scooter clip. It's very, very triggering to miss it that very first pass. Yeah. And even though there is a backup strategy involving turning around, it can be hard to go for when you're under pressure like that.
Yeah, so getting Scoot Clip first try makes it one of the fastest moons in Metro, probably the fastest moon, I guess, if we don't call like Swaying in the Breeze. But even then, it's just perfectly in our way. And if we do the drive-by clip, the very fast one, it's super quick. Unfortunate for him to miss out on that, but he just didn't want to struggle there. And then he is going to be achieving true world peace because he is actually talking to the bench friend and everybody will be happy at the end of this game.
Yes, Timpani achieving true world peace with that action.
And yes, Suisega also going to be getting that pool moon. Did time to be a little bit quicker than other options here. He does need these moons. He obviously skipped the bench friends one because he will be doing this work clip coming up pretty shortly. He still needs to gather some musicians though.
Yes, Suisega just gathering his last one, I believe. This here trumpeter.
Yeah, it seemed like it.
These musicians can be done in any order because the reset point is the same for all of them. So it's kind of up to the runner's discretion. I personally leave the trumpeter for last. I think that's just how I learned the route. But yeah, some people do opt to do him first because he tends to be the trickiest. He is the one who has the most moves in the middle.
That's true. Sorry, interesting dynamic. By the way, you could potentially do the guitarist efficiently first if you was to actually do a pretty interesting capture warp strat there. It's very hard on Suisega, second try sewer clip, easily saving time. Indeed. I was actually surprised by that.
Yes, very well executed there, making the sewers, making it through them very, very quickly here. So that will be making some time up over Timpani. I believe that the time saved is about 15 seconds on a first try.
That seems realistic, yeah.
Equates to about the same advantage that digital loads actually have. So it is kind of a sportsman play for Timpani to allow the sewer clip here. But he still does have some ground to make up.
Yeah. And getting that second try will be definitely super beneficial for him. However, as I said earlier, snow is going to be the more interesting one, because if you do get that moon clip, you will save a lot of time over some unfortunate and frustrating downstairs roll cancel clip attempts. But yeah, Timpani's going to be going through the sewer here, gets the sewer moon, and he's going to be getting the story moon as well, and then he's off to the festival. But let's look at Suisega's festival.
I'm a big fan of this particular part of the game. The music is amazing, the visuals are amazing, and it feels very satisfying to be able to get through this entire section without taking damage. We'll see if Suisega can pull that off.
Yeah, festival feeling like such a nice place to be in. The favorite music of so many is playing. You get all emotional. You revisit these old 2D style sections. Everyone is happy. But when you speedrun it, you actually can get quite scared. Because especially now, since we already took a hit there, and he actually is known to previously have died before on good pace in this particular section. The last room gets super scary.
And that's the thing with World Peace, is that there are a lot of particular chunks in World Peace that dying is a very significant time loss.
Oh no, I can't watch this! He's not going to be getting the heart. Oh, this is hard to watch now. Suisega on 1 HP, approaching these final barriers here of the festival. He just needs to play safe. Don't go too fast.
It is integral that he goes as carefully as possible here.
Okay, he's smart. That's very smart. I was super scared about that because it was like the time that he could have been sniped at one of these DK barrels, and definitely very good decision for him to wait. And because he would have been behind if he died there, he would have literally been behind Timpani. That's how punishing these deaths can be.
Yeah, just like I said, like there are many places in this World Peace race, or in this run in particular, where taking a death at the end of a boss phase or at the end of the festival is, it's game over. You lose minutes.
Yep. Like, literally, this would have been enough to equal the race here. Timpani was just starting the festival section as Suisega made it there, like, through DK. If he had taken that barrel hit if he hadn't waited there, this would have been massive. But managing to just have that patience and keep his lead, probably not the optimal festival. I mean, obviously not. But at least he's off. He's out of here.
Yeah, and on his way to the Snow Kingdom, which is probably one of the make or break kingdoms in this run, for sure. The one bit of RNG that does exist in this run also lives here, so it can be a very frustrating kingdom to get to and lose a bunch of time. So we'll see how they handle it.
Yep.
Timpani having a little bit more of a smooth festival by the looks of it.
Yeah, that looked way better and way less scary, which is a good part here. Because, yeah, Suicide are definitely making us sweat here a little. However, once again, Snow probably being my favorite kingdom, not only because of the bound ball and the prediction games that can happen there, but mainly because of the outside movement and also Snow just having very soothing music, especially in Shiveria.
Yeah, very festive, I would say.
Yeah, it just gives off that... That, I mean, it's hard to say. Actually, if you not sure if anyone played League of Legends before, but it has like the Freljord vibe. Not sure. That's something that maybe the League players will understand, me, dude.
Yes. Perhaps me, not so much. But yes, very. I think this game has a terrific soundtrack in general, to be honest. Yeah.
It is good enough to literally just hear. Like on your phone or something. Also the 2D tracks, beautiful. However, Suicide coming up at Moonclip, he is going to be attempting it, and that actually looks decently promising.
That looks really good. Oh, he's in.
Wow. This run is actually so good.
It's almost a shame that this race is against a 1.2 runner, because this would be, if not on world record pace, very, very close to it.
True. Pretty crazy here. Suisega making it over to the storage room here. And not going for any fancy stuff, just dive triple jump, and he is gonna be capturing the Treverian off to Bound Ball. We will be looking obviously at Timpani here if he can make it to the Bound Ball section cleanly. Probably also gonna be going for the Moonclip. But for now, we should take a quick guess here on Suisega's Bound Ball time as he's approaching that.
Now, I was watching him do Bound Ball earlier today. He was doing a little bit of practice. So I'm going to throw my guess in the realm of 54 seconds today. Hmm.
Interesting, interesting. So Suisega has been playing very well as Timpani unfortunately falls there on the bridge. But he has been playing very well this race. I think he might be on a roll. And since he got the snipe earlier, I'm actually going to give him the 53 on this one.
Ooh, it's a lot of trust. 53 is a very good time in the Bound Ball.
Starting off pretty quickly, though. This one was a very interesting line he took there. Making these bounces work beautifully, actually.
Yeah, and this really comes down to knowing where to land, knowing where to do the smaller bounds and the bigger bounds. Mm-hmm. So Suisega has definitely got a feel for this. Timpani also got the
That is pretty essential, especially on version 1.2. That downstairs clip is so hard on version 1.2.
I would argue that it feels like a roulette. You know, you can do the same movement and feel like you're doing the same thing, and it kind of just, you just have to hope that the game gives it to you.
Oh, Timpani going for the Shiverian Dram here. Very advanced, advanced threat. Oh, missing.
Oh, but Cappy. Cappy, of course, not cooperating.
Suisega getting stuck, actually getting a 55.
Suisega throwing the race at the very end just to not give the commentators their guesses, unfortunately. Dude.
There has to be like a betting mafia or something. I'm pretty sure that was rigged. he lost it there at the very last section. However, it's definitely interesting to note that that very last section is probably the easiest one to lose a big chunk of time.
Indeed, those big hills at the end can very easily kill your momentum. And now you see Timpani approaching the Bound Ball. What do you think here, Lim?
Oh, Timpani, a seasoned Bound Baller. He just missed the Shiverian Dram, which actually improves your time in Bound Ball around 2 seconds.
Oh yes.
So he is actually only going to be getting the 53.
You see the 53? I'm going to shoot for 52 with Timpani. I think that he's really got the movement here.
high confidence here. Having actually a slower first lap than Sui, however, Sui's last lap was definitely unoptimal. Sui already off to the outside snow in World Peace State moons, which are very fun, in my opinion, super fun, especially if you do Snowdrum, which I'm thinking we won't see. But yeah, let's see. Timpani's second lap, though, beautiful to watch.
Yes, a very low 17-second lap. Very, very close to optimal there. Sui Saiga, we see running through the kingdom, approaching this fishing section, a very frustrating section. If you don't get that first nibble, it can be tempting to just finish as well. 53, the final time. I'm going to have to give the win to you, Limpki.
Would have gotten the 51 if he got the Shivarian Dram. Unfortunate for him there. Not a big deal. So Sui Saiga is going to be opting for the timer change. Yeah, I can respect that decision for sure, especially with the lead. You don't have to lose anything, so might as well lose those 2 seconds against Snowdrum. He should be one of the most well-practiced runners when it comes to Snowdrum as a very high level any percent runner, but even still, you don't really want to throw that lead to Snowdrum.
And yeah, the unfortunate thing in World Peace is that we're talking about a 2 second time save with Snowdrum versus any percent. It's a little bit more valuable. So,
wow, interesting. Timpani just arrived here. Sui Saiga basically stealing his Odyssey as Timpani just is approaching these early moons. But yeah, Sui Saiga already off. Timpani starting these outside moons. Also, probably going to be seeing a two timer challenges here for Timpani as he's approaching the first one.
Indeed. Again, definitely the safer strategy here. Timpani trying to get his hat back from the Scarecrow. For some reason, I have a very hard time doing that myself, but it would help with capturing this bunny later. You can see him going for the spin pound spin throw strategy in order to catch the rabbit. And approaching the fishing here.
And Sui Saiga is gonna be entering the realm of Brigadier Mollusk Lancer III, Dauphin of Blobane. And yes, I actually remembered the name.
You've been doing your homework.
Jesus, I tried that for like 7 races and I finally got it. I think I got it. I might have, did I forget anything?
No, you got it all. I'm mad props. Yeah. Kerbis Big Brain in the chat if you've got it for Brigadier Mollusk Lancer the third.
Gotta put some respect on that name.
Totally. I mean, he is a Brigadier. He deserves your utmost respect.
Yeah. And he is a Dauphin of Blobane, so definitely having enough titles to deserve some respect. He simply does get the... Actually, I even put the French accent on, dude. That took me out of my work. But anyways, Timpani is off now with Snow, and Sui Saiga is going to be doing the newish seaside board. Actually, ever since this race started, this tournament started, this route was a thing. So we haven't even seen the old route at this point, but it is still a newish route that Sui Saiga is doing here.
Yes, that is true. And thankfully, it's not very difficult to pull off either. The key here is saving this little Gushin buddy. Along the railing, making sure that he's not too close to the Power Moon to trigger him disappearing or doing any funny things like that, and then just taking him for a little bit of a journey across the water and to this nearby Cheep Cheep, who's going to capture some underwater moons that are very fast and don't require any cutscenes to activate them.
Yep. Under the dangerous seating, not as dangerous as the name might suggest. Very quick moon. Shake your controller twice, basically once to activate the moon, another time to extend the hitbox of the Cheep Cheep and basically turn into the moon. And Merci Dory, another French moon. This is Sui Saiga's realm right now. Wow, that up throw! What? Well, that's actually so cool.
Very, very slick. I actually do get kind of frustrated myself when the Gushin hops out of the water like that just in time, but Sui Saiga coming up with a very brilliant strategy to make it work for him anyway.
The Synced Story Moons, this is hot right now. Obviously Sui Saiga with a pretty confident lead here, but Synced Story Moons, that up throw, Sui Saiga playing well. Timpani still creeping behind. A very unfortunate boss fight here could actually turn this on his head.
Indeed, and I think that Sui Saiga, a former world record holder of World Peace, is probably rather competent at the boss fight, but you just never know. This boss fight can sometimes cause some problems, so we'll have to see.
Yep, for sure. Yes, Sui Saiga is still having to collect one additional Story Moon before he can take on the Brigadier, and this is gonna be it. So this fight, once again, heavily scripted fight. all about knowing where to be and when to be there. And Timpani making it over to these underwater moons. But let's see how the boss fight will go for Sui.
Yes, and I would say this is probably my favorite boss fight in the game. Sui almost jumping off the cliff there, making a very smooth recovery. But now the Brigadier is down off of his perch and is ready to fight.
Yeah. He is the third after all, so he probably does have some experience when it comes to these fights. It seems like the Brigadiers here, the Dauphin of Blobanes, have been defending this realm for quite a long time. However, we still read him like a book because we are actually on another level. We speedrunners have probably fought him around 50 times, so we do know where he's going.
We've been through quite a few generations of Dauphins of Blade.
That is true. That's actually misleading. Everybody should keep their own track because this might be like the 16th for Sui, for example. But yeah, getting the clip, it seems like he did beat the boss to the hot spring, so he's already making his way over. This is actually interesting. Is he going to be going for... I was thinking, oh, he actually didn't get the clip, huh?
I think he might have. I think he just opted to cut off the boss at a different...
Yeah, I think this camera perspective was just weird for me. I got, like, distracted. But yeah, getting a pretty clean boss fight even still then, obviously.
Yeah, opting for potentially a safer strategy, not following the boss through the hot springs, but rather going around and kind of cutting him off before he's able to make his way back to the lighthouse. A little bit slower, but a little bit safer. Definitely a good idea when you're in the lead like that.
For sure. And yeah, very nice seaside again here from Sui. Almost mistakeless, being a little bit fancy as well with his up throw there on the Gushen. And Timpani also starting his boss fight here. I'm pretty sure he's very well known with that fight. It might even be like the 100th or whatever you pronounce, however you pronounce that. That's too hard for me. But Timpani definitely having fought this boss several times.
Yes. Considering he plays the All Unique Moons category, he's also well versed in Darker Side. All Unique Moons actually fights this boss twice per run. Very, very well versed in where he goes and what his mechanics are. So he should have no problems here. There is one particular strategy that not very many runners go for that involves this hot spring clip, actually, where you can kind of hop out of the Gushen at the last moment and roll across the stage and land like a spin.
Oh, Timpani!
Oh my goodness, he's down to one health here.
Okay, he is in a good spot though, so he can, if he wants to, he could even potentially get the checkpoint here at the hot springs, but he is going to be going for the snipe here. He can not miss his ground pound, gets it though. Okay, nice. And so we're already approaching Luncheon Kingdom, which is probably the kingdom with the most consistent bigger time save all around the block, you know? If you look at a kingdom like Metro, obviously we have Festival and like Sewer that could lose a bunch of time, but literally like every moon can... You can lose like 10 seconds on some of these single moons here in Luncheon.
Yeah, it's getting a good time in Luncheon is very frustrating, but also very rewarding just because of how much can go wrong. It's kind of unique in the sense where Lost Kingdom gives you kind of a consistent 20-second time loss if you die anywhere, where Luncheon is... The lava is a little bit more forgiving. It allows you to recover if you know how to get back to safe land, but it doesn't make things very fast if you take a tumble.
And Suisega with the any percent throwback. For some reason, that strat kind of... It's not a strat. That first person, something that Lil Curb started doing at some point, and ever since, every high level any percent runner has been doing it, showing some respect to the any percent guys, as he's actually still comfortably in the lead.
Indeed, making Luncheon look easy. I think there was maybe just a little bit of a hang-up on the salt pile triple at the beginning there, but recovering very quickly and not losing too much time.
But yeah, Suisega done with his Spewed fight, the rematch in World Peace. So he is already out. I mean, we will be visiting him. He will be a thing later again at the mech. But for now, Suisega actually getting that triple jump off that pole. And I think technically he would be able to also do the World Peace turnip clip here, which is actually something that we rarely see at all. And I'm pretty sure he's not even going to be attempting it. Doesn't look like it, just going for the crate.
Indeed, it kind of fits into the realm of things that save a lot of time in any percent, but save only 2 seconds in World Peace.
True. I would say Turnip Clip is less risky. Actually, though, this version of Turnip Clip that you do in World Peace is a little bit it's a little bit more sketchy. It's not probably as scary as Snowdrem. Suicide getting attacked by the Spiny.
He's getting bullied a little bit here.
Yeah, but still a little bit sketchy the way you do Turnip Clip. In World Peace, another Spiny approaching Sui, but he's just running away. He's off.
He's going to be grabbing the Story Moon just as Timpani finishes up this fight here with Spewart. Giving him a little bit of trouble at the beginning, it looks like. Just having a little bit of trickery with the first phase, but finishing it off just fine.
Mm-hmm. And this is actually a recurring thing now. Both of these runners being at respective their own Story Moons. One Story Moon between them and one Story Moon section between them. However, obviously, I think the lead still is actually growing on Sui here, and it does take him probably a pretty big misery here, like either a boss fight death or just several mistakes. So Sui definitely still playing very solid. However, late game is always scary, and it will never stop being scary.
Indeed. We are still in Luncheon, and there are a lot of places where things can go wrong. This particular section is very reminiscent of Any Percent. So it's in Sui's ballpark, I would say. But as we pass this multi-moon, this multi-meat moon coming up here, it is all World Peace movement, and there are some unique sections that maybe he's not so comfortable with, so we'll have to see.
Yep. Exactly. And Timpani also, obviously, since he's in 1.2, not even having a chance to opt for this Turnip Clip, since that's an unavailable trick in that version. He's also going to be getting the Cheese Moon. Very nice movement there. Very well-spaced roll into a nice spin throw. Let's see how this cheese is going. Not perfect. Not the worst as well, though. Yeah, not perfect, but not the worst. And Sui already going towards this timer challenge here, going for a quick roll cancel rather than the scary spin throw version. And also for a backflip. I do not like that. Yeah, and we see why here. It's really hard to get the wall jump after that.
Yeah, certain jumps and certain angles tend to not really work with Mario wanting to cling to the wall for a wall jump strategy there. Sui having the advantage of having Cappy on that very, very treacherous jump there, though, so being able to play it safe. Ooh, but taking a little bit of a tumble on these weird geometry blocks here.
Yep.
Making the climb a little bit awkward for himself.
He needs to come up with something on the fly here, as the geometry, especially of these polygon-like, low poly-like, rocks here, which in my opinion is like gorgeous, super cool design for a kingdom, but very annoying to do movement on, especially fast movement. As Timpani shows it up perfectly with the timing, does he know the backup? He does.
Ooh,
because you
yes.
can't run up this slope.
But he still takes a death. Oh no. That's
very
unfortunate.
One.
Luckily, he did get the Among Tall Mountains moon, so he can make his way directly to Mipoto now, but still a very costly mistake there.
What? How did he wall jump there? What?
That was definitely out of a dive. That should not have happened.
Wait, what? Everything is happening right now. Simply pretty much showing why these structures are super weird. The wall jumping out of a dive. Ha. Huh. Interesting.
Yes, yeah, a very interesting set of movements there. Making it up to the meat multi-moon. As Suisaga approaches the final part of Luncheon here, he's going to be doing the Koopa free-running movement, which is another one of my very favorite parts of this particular kingdom.
But yeah, Suisaga going for very quick movement here, getting the home in. Cappy turn jump, spin pound, quick spin throw! Actually, I didn't even know that's possible on that one. That looked so sick. Suisaga going for some strats I'm even not even aware of right now.
I feel like everybody has a little bit of their own flavor when it comes to that, that section there. It's very, very, very cool to watch.
But that's actually probably faster. Like, that spin throw has to be faster than the up throw because Cappy basically, like, glitched up the wall and that was so quick. And the up throw actually is the slowest throw in the game as far as actual frame data goes. You can actually, like, count the frames. Oh, Timpani! Not getting the spin pound.
Taking a bit of a dive there. He's gonna have to make his way back up the climb. And it seems like both of these runners actually having quite a bit of difficulty with making their way up here.
Yeah, this section especially.
And Suisaga here actually in the Cuckatiel fight, infamously a very tricky fight to deal with because the hitboxes are not very friendly, but Suisaga making it look very easy, in fact.
Yeah, making him look actually not the very worst. But yeah, Suisaga, Dungeon Kingdom, probably can be decently happy that is out of that one. Probably actually, but if you look at the grand scheme of things, wasn't his cleanest kingdom. You know, taking some damage, getting attacked by Spinies, bonking in some places, but still showing off nice movement options though. So still liking that part.
Yes, and you know, not to discredit the run at all, because he is still on excellent pace.
Yeah, for
going
sure.
Into the any percent portion of this run here, as we enter Ruined, which is obviously the hardest kingdom in the game.
He made like tiny mistakes, but we actually haven't gotten to see him make many mistakes yet. That's why the only reason why it kind of
noticed it. That's why it sticks out. It's kind of funny. Yeah. That's exactly what Timpani and I were saying with Stravos's run the other day.
Yep.
When we have to point out a bonk as the major mistake in a run, you know it's a good one.
I also did like Timpani's movement there. Very flashy looking as well. And Suisaga off to Ruined Kingdom. We will be respective boss fights here. Timpani might actually already be done with Cuckatiel as Suisaga starts off his Ruined fight. But let's see if Timpani has good luck with these hitboxes.
Yes, hitting the belly from underneath kind of triggers the phase of this fight, which is kind of a unique aspect of the fight. You can see him taking damage from absolutely nothing there, which is another very characteristic trait of this fight. Very frustrating to deal with sometimes.
And yeah, Timpani making his way here on the second phase, getting the hit, and Suisaga starting off the dragon fight. This is probably the one section where if Sui was to die here for some reason, it would be enough for Timpani to catch up even still. Like, that's just the time loss of bosses in this game.
Especially this one.
Yeah, especially this one.
It's completely not unheard of to see somebody take a death in this particular section. It's not incredibly easy to take a death in this section, but at the same time, we have seen it happen on world record pace, in fact, before. And
exactly.
It's just the name of the game sometimes.
But yeah, Ruined phase number 2. This one still to go, and then another phase where the dragon only shoots one array of lightning circles, I guess, or whatever this attack would be called.
Little lightning wheels of sorts, I suppose.
I guess wheels.
You're just doing your best to avoid them, and I think everybody kind of has their own waiting movement here, as well, because there's nothing you can really do. I like 1.2 because they give you a little cat and toad to play with.
Yeah, true.
I like to dance something around to with do. Them. Yep. Aside from that, you just kind of activate your hearts and you just wait. Suisaga obviously going for this strategy here that allows him to damage boost through and get control of Mario just in time to make these phases really fast, showing it off very, very quickly, and the boss is down.
But yeah, very solid fight here for Sui. Easily made short work of the dragon. No deaths, and he's going to be off to Bowser's, which is just the next scary place here after this one. Late game in this game. Gotta be sweating a little bit.
Indeed. And the nerves can be high, especially in a race. And I think that sometimes we downplay what Bowser's is all about just because we say, oh, it's, you know, it's like any percent. But that can't be understated that just because it's any percent doesn't mean it's not difficult, because it certainly
yep.
is.
Yeah, for sure. And Timpani's still doing the dragon fight here, just started that one off. Suisaga still being in Ruined Kingdom though, just repairs the Odyssey. I mean, I guess the Odyssey repairs itself from the mist and the power of the moons here. But he will be off to Bowser's right now, which obviously has the mech fight going on, which is very hard boss fight.
Indeed, and there's many strategies we've developed to make this fight really fast, but I feel like the more tech we add, the more difficult it actually gets. to stay on top and to not fall off the boss at any point. So it'll be a very nerve-wracking part of the run for both of these runners.
For sure, Tempani fighting the dragon here on the second phase, getting the pins off quickly enough. And Suicide going over to that first story mode. He's not going to be doing the wall, the moon behind the big wall, which is a personal preference. You can basically decide between two moves, which ones your movement is more confident on, which ones you want to get. Optimally, the moon these days, the moon behind, like in the corridor, behind the crates, would be a little bit faster. And Timothy actually only one HP. I do not want to see big memes here. These little enemies can be quite annoying. He does manage to go through though.
Yes, just making it by without any troubles there. A little bit scary, but he's through the boss fight and on to the other side.
Yep. First moon acquired. Suicide is going to be going for that corridor moon, which once again, if you do very, very optimal movement, it's potentially fast, at least as far as we know at this day, but every day there could be another strat for the other moon and make that quicker again. So this is the perfect example of a personal preference moon. It's literally not worth to switch between them and learn the fastest move for them. Just stick with one and make it work as good as you can, in my opinion.
I would say the same, yeah. If you're comfortable with one, you might as well stick with one. It comes down to frames, I think, as far as the optimal movement goes.
Yep.
For those two.
Yeah, exactly. Well, so we're getting shot here by one of these cannonballs. He is recovering from it. However, he is going to be taking a damage refill on that story moon, replenishing his health, and going to be getting a little bit of an animation losing 2 seconds.
Yes. Very minimal in the grand scheme of things, but these could all add up to some major time losses. If Timpani plays really well, we could still see an upset here.
True. Mech being the next scary thing here for Suicide as he approaches the beginning of basically the boss re-boss fight sections. You still get an additional moon here, the one of the roof, one of the very fastest ones you have access to. Just make a little detour around, and the moon's just sitting there.
Opting to go for the strategy where you jump up the roof from the one side rather than the capture warp strategy, in my opinion, probably the safer of the two.
For sure. We did see runs die to both of these strategies before, by the way. It's a very famous run that Valu, who actually recently returned to the speed game, actually ended up taking a death to. But we obviously also saw runs before die to that capture warp strat. So definitely a fast but scary moon.
Yes, a dive was named very infamously after him, after an unfortunate death on world record pace to that moon. A game mechanic that involves a backflip into a cap throw dive that does not give you the planned direction.
Yep.
And killing the run there. And yes, it's very, very infamous place for a run to end, in fact. Bowser's Kingdom in general. Not only are your deaths falling deaths, but you have to fall all the way down to the death zone, which loses a lot of time just in itself.
So you're actually missing a Harriet bomb there. I wonder if that's an occurrence of him having a little bit too much sand Harriet practice. But I mean, that's obviously a mistake that can happen to anyone. As he's starting his topper refight here, getting quick hits in at the start. And the scary thing about topper is, even though he is not necessarily hard, making a mistake would be quite annoying. He manages to go through here without any issues though.
Yes, and missing one of the jumps on his hat circle causes the hats to start flying around the stage, and if you have not kept track of where he is, it can be a little bit frustrating and very time costly.
Simply managing to pass by Shards here, solid movement, gaining that story moon here, and pretty much once again, one story moon apart. It seems like that won't change for now, as Suicide and Timpani basically watching these cutscenes at the same time.
Yes, that's right, and Suicide collecting the very last of the story moons here on the way up to the very final, very difficult part of the run, I would argue, yep, which is the Robobrood fight.
And Timpani, it looked like, actually opted to not do the behind the big one. Well, he actually did. Yeah, true. He doesn't have the refight. No, he didn't.
He
actually
moons.
Decided to opt out of that one, because usually he's one of the people that would do that. Also, he's one of the people that does topper first.
Yes. Which is the superior strat, from what I've been told.
No, that's wrong. But I mean...
Again, I think that it's actually rather cool that Battle Kingdom had these moments of personal preference. Kind of really spices it up. Doesn't lose or gain you any time as long as you're playing optimally.
Very rare occasion, but there is some spots in this game where this is a thing. So, Sui approaching the Mecha Brutal, the Robo Brute, the Mech, I guess, here. Let's see how this one goes. Fast climb at the very start and gets a very quick spin point in as well. The second hit is probably the easiest one if you manage to make that first hit land. After that, it's pretty much only the Harriet third strike, which I'm very sure Sui Saga is going to be going for.
Yes, it's kind of the standard for the any percent runners at the moment. Is proven to save about a second and a half, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, it depends on how well you do that hit on Harriet. It might even save two. There's just no comparison because people just started doing this fight and the top runners just perfected this one. Right. Let's see if Susega gets it here, sets up for the target acquired one where you just get the hit and immediately in very fast spin pound to clutch that out.
That's a textbook Robo Brute fight. Very, very solid there.
Yeah, and I gotta say, this strategy looks super scary. However, I actually just recently started to change it, like do this instead of the fast spirit hit because I was having issues with it. And these days, I actually feel like the Harriet third strat is easier to be consistent with because there's a very, very clear setup where you need to stand. And as long as you buffer your spin pound in time and make it and execute it quickly, it's actually not too hard. But I mean, it is scary and it is late in the run.
Yeah, and that's the thing is like, with any of these new strategies, especially for a particular section that's already difficult, it can be even scarier to go for something new in a run on PB pace, especially. So it's just sometimes easier to go with the thing you're most comfortable with.
Yep. And Sui finishing off Bowser's here on very, very solid pace. We can actually not forget the fact that he did end up not doing the first moon skip here, losing a little bit of time in the clips, not like first try clips, but super solid run. I feel like this could be close to, I mean, probably not close to world record pace even with first moon skip, but I think this is still potential to get a 116.
He would have to play.
No, okay, never mind.
He would have to have a BTT moon kingdom.
Like,
I
literally.
Believe. So
yeah,
we are still looking at a 117, a very low 117, which is very commendable considering the first moon skip did not happen in this race. So very, very solid showing from Sui Saiga.
But yeah, super solid run so far. It's not over yet. There's still some sections simply opting to go for an attempt of hitting Spewart there. And yeah, this is pretty much what has been happening to me. This feels like the more awkward strategy. It's just been around for longer, but I feel like the one where you hit Harriet at the third and end with Spewart seems to be better for me these days. But let's see if Timpani can recover quickly enough without taking any major damages here. Actually, only one HP. This gets super scary now.
It's very, very nerve-wracking. Having to avoid the steps, but collecting the heart.
The clutchness. Oh no, one HP again. Timpani getting in the third hit.
Okay, he's got the third hit now.
Oh no, the ES. Ended up bonking there. Can he still make it back up? He gets up. Yes. He gets the hit.
Woo! Very, very nerve-wracking time there.
Timpani managing to beat the mech. And Sui Saiga is entering the cathedral here. Very easy looking moon skip for him. And he's going to be off to his Bowser refight.
Yes, and I've kind of timed this to be, if you do everything in the cathedral and past optimally, you're looking at about 3 minutes and 55 seconds. So we can see Sui Saiga getting a low 117 here, as long as everything in the escape goes correctly.
And I guess this fight as well, specifically the second phase, seems to be quite scary in some good pace runs because not because of the good pace, but just because of how the second phase works. You do not have a damage boost to make that fast head grab work, so you need to time everything properly without getting hit unintentionally. So let's see if he gets that. He actually made Bowser stand on one of these lower platforms, which makes it easier to make that backflip work in a nice spot, so he gets that head grab without an issue.
Indeed, and if you're ever worried about this phase, I recommend trying to hit it a little bit later, just so that Bowser doesn't take his hat back and you end up saving a little bit more time for your mistake rather than losing.
I see Danger's hitting me up with the uncautious critique there, watching my runs and missing that second phase every time, recently for some reason, but that's something I might try. Esui Saiga does have access to a damage boost here on this third phase, making this set way easier. He gets it as well, and he is probably, as long as he doesn't get hit twice here for some reason, off to the escape section.
Yeah, my very textbook Moon Bowser fight, followed up by the escape section, and I do not think that the moon is particularly difficult. However, just about every part of the moon is very time costly.
Yep.
Dying within the beginning portion sends you all the way back to the Odyssey, which of course loses you a bunch of time, especially with those moon physics. Dying within the Bowser fight is obviously very costly because you have to do the whole thing again, and the same goes for the escape sequence. You have to do the entire thing again at any point of the failure, including the pillar room at the end, which can be very, very traumatic.
This is the one tricky thing, because it does seem like there's like a semi-loading zone between the pillar room and that end escape section. But for some reason, it's not counted as these regular loading zones that would spawn you back there if you die. That's not the case on pillars. If you die in pillars, you will be starting the entire escape section again, potentially losing easily over a minute. More like almost two, as that 2D skip looked easy for Sui.
Yeah, making his way. Ooh, Tiffany taking a dive. Oh no, and missing the moon cave skip.
Straight into the abyss. He was actually doing a backflip there, and I think he might have actually gotten one of the Valu dives. I'm not completely sure, because he did, for some reason, I mean, this is personal preference again, but he did a backflip after the moon cave skip. Usually you'd see people either do a single jump or a side flip, and maybe that backflip actually caused him to miss Cappy there as he tried to make it over to the entrance of the cathedral.
Very unfortunate circumstance. He's going to have to make his kind of roll of shame all the way back to the moon cave skip. Yeah.
Brought it up earlier here, actually ended up becoming a reality.
Commentator's curse.
Potentially. As Esui Saiga is about to hit his last pillar, something we couldn't really keep track of as he was playing super well. Probably, actually, as we saw it coming, seems to be a very, very low 117. As he's clawing in on that final block, going to be capturing the Y here, maybe barely going to be getting a 117.10. That goes well. Looks just like it.
Very, very solid showing from Esui Saiga. Very close to his PB, I believe.
So this is where it does get interesting. Esui Saiga and Stravos, both in semis. These guys have been racing in the Any% final. I mean, we do know there's a lot of recurring things happening in World Peace. There's still major differences, but turns out that these guys are pretty good at racing, and turns out that these guys are potentially meeting up again.
It's very true. They're on opposite ends of the bracket. These were the finalists for the Any% GSA tournament that we recently had. So it'll be very interesting to see if they're able to clutch out wins in their semifinals matches as well. And we might see a rematch in the finals. It'll be interesting.
Yeah, I'm looking forward for that one, because we had like an insanely close race in that finals match, especially the first one of the series was literally, it was almost decided in that Bowser's fight, as Strauss ended up missing two head grabs. But still managing to actually take it 2-0. And Stravos obviously looks scary. One thing that I do want to bring up here, Stravos is undefeated in GSA races. He hasn't been beaten yet in anything.
That's incredible.
Like, not in a series, not in... I mean, he has been beaten in one of these showcase races when we were doing like four like four-way showcase races. But as far as any percent of Wolpe goes, unbeaten yet, he's been going for a hot streak. And Suiseiger also showing off that he's capable of these very, very good race times. And this is going to be probably, like, if that happens to be the final, it's going to be scary. We do want to bring up that we do have another... We still don't know who Suiseiger's opponent is going to be. We are going to be having a race between Suiseiger and either Ottimi or Little Curbs, I think.
That's right, yes.
Yep. And yeah, Strava's going to be racing Rhea, which is another interesting matchup.
Yes, and we're looking at some very solid competitors here. I believe everybody that is remaining has a very, very solid time on the Any% leaderboards. Rhea is not the world record in Legacy World Peace category, yep, out of everybody that remains, including Timpy and myself. In fact, we both had the world record in the current patch for World Peace. It's just a very, very solid top eight competitors in this tournament still, so we'll just have to see how it goes. I think that the Little Curbs and Oddmi match is going to be an incredibly exciting matchup as well.
Yeah, insanely close. Like, these guys are so close in terms of skill levels, and anything can happen in these races. We like Suiseiger, let's be real, the festival death, it actually could have happened. He was super close. I mean, he had respect to him once again for playing it safe there and having the patience to not run into a barrel. So these things, they are apparent in every run. And this is why these matchups cannot be totally predicted. But even if so, it's going to be super close. We are going to be having that on Saturday. And also, by the way, all of these races are going to be happening just right before the finals here, because we will be having these finals on the upcoming Monday. As Timpani manages to end his run here with, it looked like a 121.06 for me.
Yes, I think I saw that work as well. Closing it up strong after that moon death. Unfortunately, not going to be able to pull out the win here.
But yeah, obviously several unlucky occurrences here for Timpani, as he ended up taking a death or two in spots where it's definitely a little bit painful to take. These runs, as we just brought up, have these potential big time losses. And Suiseiger on his end having a very clean run. We cannot underestimate that, ending that with a low 117. And this is without first moon skip, which is these days actually considered a fairly easy trick with the water version of it. So you could almost consider that a 116. I mean, you can't, but still, the potential is there, and we know.
Indeed. And, you know, even... I think that Timpani took some very unfortunate mistakes towards the end of the run, but this 117.10 is actually a better showing than any 1.2 time posted, so it would have been very, very difficult to beat regardless. Yep. So a very, very good showing from Suiseiger.
And it is also, in my opinion, worth to mention that this is probably going to be turning into a 1.0 exclusive tournament. No, is Rhea on 1.2 still?
Rhea is on 1.0 now.
Oh, he's on 1.0 back again. So it's going to be 1.0 exclusive tournament at this point, which is just going to mean basically at this point that we have potential to see at least 1.0 world records, as all of these guys apparently have the potential to do these in races. But yeah, definitely very exciting ones. Nonetheless, cool stuff happening. Suiseiger showing some swaggy up throws and strats around the board. Timpani wall jumping off of dives.
Yes, and... which, you know, apparently is a thing that can happen.
Yep, I guess. Very interesting. So I do want to make you guys aware of the fact that we will be having a ton of Super Mario Odyssey speedrunning content coming up with our first triple bingo race in just about 2.5 hours. And I'm awfully excited to cast triple bingo. I'm getting like sucked into triple bingo right now. It's super fun. There's going to be a ton to talk about.
Indeed, I'm also very excited about this myself. I just started getting into bingo, and I think that it kind of levels the playing field out to have that extra level of routing and possibilities and just being able to use your knowledge of the game as an advantage in a thing like this. It's very exciting and very fun to do. So I'm very much looking forward to this tournament. The first one, I believe, yes, you said in 2.5 hours.
Yep. That's going to be our first race. Make sure to peep this one. We are potentially going to be seeing some changes in the presentation as well. I cannot confirm anything yet, but definitely make sure to check that one out. And also, you guys should probably stay around here in these upcoming days. We will be having a ton of not only bingo matches, we will be having these very close semis and the last quarterfinal of the World Peace Tournament. There's going to be the task results showcase on Saturday. Stacked this weekend is going to be stacked again. So make sure to follow Speedrun SMO. And I hope to see you guys again. And you can also already almost get heated up for the finals on Monday. A ton of content coming up. Make sure to drop that follow. And I hope you'll make it, you'll enjoy it. And Dangerous, thank you so much for that co-commentary.
Anytime, thank you. It's always a pleasure. Thank you for having me. And drop all of these racers a follow if you haven't already. Timpani, Sui Saga, incredible members of the community. They do excellent speedruns in their own respective categories. So give them a follow. Give Limcube a follow. He's an incredible spokesman for GSA and for all of Super Mario Odyssey as a community.
Follow Dangerous. But anyways, guys, thank you so much for sticking with us and thank you so much for being active in the chat and enjoying that one. And we do hope to see you in the next GSA race. Have a good one and see you potentially in 2.5 hours with Triple Bingo.
Farewell, friends.